and gentlemen, again from the Grand Sierra Resort, live in Reno, Nevada. We'd like to welcome you to day number two of the 22nd U.S. Bar Table Championships. And we're about to open things up today with a one-loss side match between Amar Kang and Danny Olson. And if you were with us yesterday, you know that we started with about, I think it was 105 players in the 10-ball division. We are paring our way down to where our target is by the end of the last match tonight, the 8:30 match tonight. We should have our two finalists, and that will take place sometime tomorrow. We'll let you know what time that's going to happen later today as we finalize it, because 9-ball starts tomorrow, and we want to make sure that we have a good slot to put that 10-ball final in for you. And we thank all of you for joining us once again here. We're really building to a great conclusion once we get to the 8-ball division. We're well over 200 men and over 60 women already. So that's going to be a pretty exciting event. But here we go, Danny breaking in the first rack. So just want to make sure we give due credit to our great sponsors that have stood tall to help us again here. OB is the official cue of the U.S. Bar Table Championships and one of our three signature sponsors, along with Kamui, the official tip of the USBTC, and of course, CueSports International. As opposed to years past, this year we have no side events going on. It is solely the three divisions of the USBTC for the men and the women. No nine-footers are here. There's no other events that we've had here in the past that have occasionally given us a little conflict with scheduling. So hopefully things will go nice and smooth today. We'll stay right on schedule for all of our matches and keep the flow moving. And meanwhile, Danny's working his way nicely through the opening rack here. Going to have to take just a little longer shot on the 7. I don't think he's going to go too much below the side here. Well, he was able to do that and executed it quite well. As I'm sure all of you are aware, but for anybody that's joined us for the first time today, you're able to follow the brackets for this entire event, men and women, all three divisions, live as it's updated on either the CueSports International website, which would be CTS On Demand. And again, we want to make sure that we recognize Kamui for being the official tip of the U.S. Bar Table Championships. You can see their logo displayed right there. And not to come in second, equally as important, OB, the official cue of the U.S. Bar Table Championships, And they're now known as OB. It was OBQs for many, many years, and that's still their website address, but we refer to them now as simply OB at their request. So thanks, guys. Okay, Amar to break, rack number two. Two ball, four ball, and a shot at the one. Looks like a fairly nice layout here. Looks like he's playing it in, playing the eight here. And that's exactly what he did, and that just about is resulted in connect the dots now for the balance of this rack. It'll be a very routine transition from the seven to the nine when he finally gets there. Any angle on the seven works, and the nine can be a stop shot, as you can see, because the ten's just sitting in front of the other side pocket. You would expect this to be a break and run. Nicely done for Amar. So two break and runs to open the match here. And that's just the way we like to see it. While Danny's racking, I'm going to go over the rules one time for everybody this morning. Again, this is 10 ball. It's call ball in pocket. You don't have to call obvious shots, but you do have to call banks and combinations. You can only call one ball per shot. A legal break is strike the one ball first and either make a ball or four balls to the cushions. If that's not done, it's a foul, ball in hand. The 10 doesn't count on the break in any pocket. It spots immediately. Cue ball fouls only. Push out after the break, of course. Three foul rule is in effect. And the one different stipulation here, of course, is if you illegally pocket a ball, your opponent has the choice to accept the table or turn it back over to you. Clarify that illegally pocketed here after Danny breaks. Oh, he flew that right into the side and almost went in on the fly. And that's just what Amar was hoping for, an opportunity to break serve here. Anyway, just to clarify the illegally pocketed ball, that would occur in one of two situations. The ball you're intending to play goes in other than the intended pocket, or you don't make the ball you've intended to make and something else goes in. Both those situations would give the opponent the option. Nothing would spot unless it was the 10 illegally pocketed. So those are the rules. And it's alternate break, by the way, and of course it is still race to seven. It's true double limb, race to seven on both sides of the chart, and when we get to the finals, the gentleman in the hot seat will have to be beaten twice by the opponent from the left side in order to become the champion. I think he might want to play the three in the same pocket. I don't know. It just lays, looks like it lays better that way, but it's going to stay right there. The only reason I preferred the other pocket, I thought would be easier to get to the four and take the nine out of play. It shouldn't be a problem for him anyway. hit that just about 3 feet. Excuse me, I'm quite sure he was not playing for the side. Now it looks like he's going to have to play it in the side and maybe hope the cue ball runs into the six. If he can miss the six and get over where the cue ball is now, that's okay too. Good, but he's not going to get a reward for it. Pardon me, and that's partly because he got kind of funny there on the six after messing up his position on the four ball. Okay, he's declared them frozen. Danny said okay. I don't think it's going to make much difference. He's going to have to try to masse this and get up here behind the nine somewhere, maybe the 10. Well, the poor position play on the four is likely going to cost him this rack. And that's how delicate things are at this level now that we're getting pretty deep into the event. You just cannot turn the table over to a quality opponent. Stayed down very nicely on that ball there too. Good shot. So Danny broke that rack, flew the cue ball right into the side pocket, and Amar had ball in hand with an open layout and he couldn't complete the run. So Danny kind of held his serve there, and it's 2-1 now for Danny. Okay, the 10 went right in. It's going to spot now. Lamar will continue at the table. Hard to tell if he's got any part of the one on the right-hand side to hit. Doesn't really look like it. I think he's looking at a real first shot, which actually will, if he can execute it and pocket the ball, the two is right there. However, this is a sellout big time if you attempt to make the ball and don't. The kick and stick would be okay, except the five and six ball are in the path that the one might take, one or two rails if he plays it like that. So not really sure what the best approach is here. He's going to push for a longer kick and that's probably okay. I think I'd give it back. Yeah, I think that's a good decision there by Danny. Now, if I was Amar, I might kick the other way off the short rail and try to just put the one up there with that traffic, and maybe I'll get lucky and get the cue ball behind the three. But again, if he's trying to make this, it could sell out unless it hits the short rail and comes back. Let's see how he tries it. Yeah, it was the hit and stick, and that was what I thought might happen, was the one would hit the 5-6. I mean, he didn't sell out the game, but Danny can certainly hit the one ball. He might play the four. I don't know. It just seems that might be the best kind of a two-way shot. Well, he's going to get away with the leave, but if the four drops, he's going to shoot again, because Amar has the option now. I don't know, maybe Amar will take this and play safe. It's just hard to see how much of the one he can get. That was nice. This is a tough ball to hit now. Very tough ball to hit. This is the five. I bet that's probably no more than a 50-50 hit there, playing the ball that way. He had a guard against hitting the seven coming in, and he had to shoot the cue ball out to the right and then bring it back with left, so very, very tough. Looks like Amar's going to try to go for three fouls here because he has no pocket for the one ball, so like that cue ball wedged right in there. Where he takes a couple of the cushions away from Danny. And again, nicely done. Hard to see if there's even a path to get to the one ball. And maybe three rails behind it, but that looks pretty tough. The five's taken up a lot of the space to go two or three rails. The only other thing I would see would be to shoot to the left of the three ball with a lot of left English, one rail, and try to bend it back, come straight up the table at the one. Yeah, that's the three rail shot he's looking at there. One of the problems he'll have trying to do that is hitting the right side of the cue ball because of the presence of the seven. He can't get the cue tip much more than maybe a half a tip to the right of center. But I I'd be really surprised if he hits this. And he's on one foul right now, but this is like, I don't know if he's going two rails there, three rails, or one rail, but none of it's easy. He's going three. Wow, I'm telling you, that's, don't scratch after that hit. Oh, that's really, really cold. That was as good a hit as I've seen all week. And now he's on two. Amar's going to try to run these out. I don't see any reason for him to do anything else. If he gets in trouble, he can always play safe. But he accomplished what he wanted to accomplish, which was getting the ball in hand. But still a really nice hit on a awfully tough ball to hit there. You can see the six will clearly pass the eight, even though the eight doesn't have any of the pocket blocked. You still have the perception that you've almost got to cheat it a little bit. I think you'd like to get kind of close to the six. And that's pretty good there. Now he's got the proper angle to just draw the cue ball straight up the table for the seven in the side. But once again, he'll need to take some care on the angle on the seven. He doesn't want to be straight in on it. That's good. I would suspect him to play this in the side. I think it's just more natural for position, but he might be able to float it straight down by playing it in the corner. Well, nice work following the ball in hand by Amar. Ties the match up at two apiece. Much better cue ball, but nothing down. And push out. tough to find a spot to push here. Probably going to go ahead and take a jump shot, and I think that might be the best decision. A lot of times, if there's no good place to push, you might as well go ahead and do something maybe a little bit more offensive. Most of the time, the guy that pushes out is going to get the worst of it. Even if he were to make this and have to kick at the two, I think that's still better than pushing on the one. Well, you can certainly tell that the five is the problem ball here. It doesn't pass. He's looking now to see if it'll go from there. He does have the four nearby. He had to wind up shooting the four in the side and then running into the eight with the cue ball to try to bump the five out. Even if he cut straight in on the three and stopped, he could shoot the four in the upper right and go into the 8-5 as well with the cue ball. But that's certainly one of the things he's going to have to deal with if he wants to get out. He's clear to the two. He can see it and make it. But now that he's moved the three, he most likely is going to have to use the four to open those up. If he could get right where the seven ball is, he might be able to do it off the three. But not now. Gave that five a lot of look earlier when the three ball was over there, and he's looking again, and just based on the position he played on the four, it would seem to indicate that he's thinking he can make that five, or he's just going to play safe behind the eight if he's got enough of the five to hit and stick. So we will know momentarily, and you'll know if the hit's good, because if the eight moves, it's a foul. Good eyes there. Very workmanlike job there, Danny. Got through a fairly challenging rack. Okay, this is the rack number 6. 3-2 for Danny. And he did exactly what Danny did. Sent it right into the side pocket. The 2 and 3 are tied up. I'm sure Danny will go have a peek. With ball in hand on the 1, he'll have a little bit of an opportunity to open those up, even though the 10's there. He's got to open them anyway. Even if the 10 wasn't there, he had no pocket for the deuce. But it looks like he's going to have to just play the 1 in the upper right corner and come one rail at the 3 ball with the cue ball. He's got to hit the right side of the 3 as we're looking at it, which will bump the 2 to the short rail. The 3 will stay there, and the cue ball hopefully will glance off to the right as we're looking. And it doesn't have to be hit with a great deal of speed, because you don't need a lot of separation between the deuce and the 3. It's not bad. You could tell he hit the 3 right on the nose. He probably wanted to hit it a little bit more to the right. The 2 would have still gone where it is, but the cue ball would have been in a little easier position. But this isn't that bad, because the 3 has clearance now to this corner. It's just a question of, can he hold the cue ball? Or is he gonna risk trying to sneak it around the 4, 2 rails? Dangerous if it hits that. Oh boy, he got away with it. Made a nice shot too on the deuce. And this is pretty much sort of game ball here if he can just float across even halfway for the 4. Well, he made Amar pay for a scratch on the break with a run out. And now Danny has a chance to extend his lead even further. Shane is the defending 10 ball champion, as he is also the defending 9 ball champion here. Corey is the defending eight ball champion. As I was mentioning earlier, you can follow the online brackets at ctsondemand.com or on badboysbp.com. That's Bad Boys Billiard Productions, Bad Boys BP, our tournament direction team. And a lot of cool stuff on their website in addition to the flow charts. So here we go with rack 7, Danny 4-2 ahead. A little bit appetizing. He's looking at the 4-5, which is going to be the key to this rack. And I think you can maybe already predict that one of the things he's going to be concerned about is having the 4 move by the 9 ball after he makes the 5. And of course, he'll need to get the cue ball out too, but that shouldn't be a problem. Semi-straight in here on the 3 is good. Well, that's even better. That'll get him closer. I wouldn't want my cue ball on the long rail here for the 4-5. I'd want it at least a foot or foot and a half off the rail, so even though you're having to cut the 4 the other way. It'll get your cue ball out where you need it. And that's going to be just fine there, because now you can see the natural path of the cue ball is going to go across. You just got to make sure that even if the 4 grazes the 9, it gets to the short rail. Nicely done. Oh, white ball, where are you going? Oh my gosh, I would not have expected him to have risked putting the cue ball in that pocket. I think he put so much of his attention. He knew the cue ball was going to be over there. I think he put so much attention on controlling the 4 ball, he just overlooked the possibility of the cue ball getting away from him, and that's a huge turnover right there for Amar, because the rest of the rack was just sitting there for Danny. He would have been 5-2 up. Now Amar has a chance to break, run this out, and maybe break and get even. Kind of picked his pocket on that one. Well, he gave Amar some help anyway. Showed him where his wallet was. So 4-3 for Danny. Amar breaking to tie it up. Equipment is 7-foot diamond tables with pro cut 4.5-inch pockets. Simonis 860 Tour Blue. We're using the Magic Rack and Cyclop pool balls. And we have really come to have a great relationship with Cyclop. Now that the balls have been in use for a couple of years around the country, I think the players have settled in nicely with them. And they do play well, they really do. Stroke here to get back for that deuce. He needs to be about where he is now on that line. So if he can miss the other side pocket, then he's going to miss the seven. And he did. Boy, that was well struck. Beautiful shot, Danny. He just smooth stroked it, went really nice and clean through that cue ball. Probably couldn't have come out much better. I think he'd like to move the nine away from the six to clear the pocket. So I think he's looking at kind of a punch, like a stun run through here, if I see the angle correctly, or possibly just follow it and bump the nine to the long rail. Yep. It's just, see those little things like that that just help you get through a rack. You got to be able to recognize them, and then you got to be able to do it. And he certainly did both. He's got to stay under the seven here. Maybe just kill this with a little low inside. Pretty nice transition there from the 9 to the 10. Obviously the 3 rail off pattern path was not there. And he had to beat the side pocket scratch and then the corner pocket scratch, but he did it. And he has a 5-3 lead and he's breaking. neither guy's had a whole lot of success on the break. They've each scratched once. Balls just aren't coming apart the way they're hitting them. Good shot, Amar. Looks like he might be able to draw right into the seven ball here and stop the cue ball. If he's on that side of the three, he's got a couple of pockets for it. Maybe he'd like to hit the seven right on the nose. Oh, he caught the eight a little bit, and it's covered up a good portion of the three. We'll have to see if he's got enough of it to cut it in the side. And that's even if the eight wasn't there, cutting that ball in the side's not easy. Yeah, that was his call, between the side. And he really doesn't know where the cue ball's going because it's going to probably hit the four. If it misses the four, it's going into parts unknown. Good shot. No reward again, but he did the best he could. I mean, you know, you got to make the ball, and you had to use the low right that he used to help make the ball. Had the cue ball come a little further, he might have had a look at the four on the side, but now it's probably going to have to be a safe. Got him, and I think that's a well-played safe by Amar, if he did in fact hook him. And he obviously did, if Danny's looking that way. There's such a big advantage when you hook somebody, when you freeze them to that object ball, you just take away at least 50% of their options and a portion of the cue ball for them to strike too. I mean, he was looking, you know, one rail under the six here, but he's just going to tie this up, I think. I'd be surprised if he does anything, but even though the four's sitting right there, and if Mara's ball in hand, he's going to be able to open up any cluster that Danny might create. Three rails, short. Good effort. Hooked. Guess not. That was dangerous. Thank you. Amar took advantage of his opportunity after that nice safety he played on the four ball. Got the ball in hand and got out. 5-4, his break. See if Amar makes any adjustment here on his break shot. Sucked it right in the side last time. Ten ball break on a bar table is so radically different than on the 9-footer because you've got so many collisions right after the break, especially with the cue ball. You could tell there was so much topspin on that cue ball after it rocked back after striking the one. It just propelled itself right into the pocket, and that tells me that he didn't strike it where he wanted to. You don't want to hit your cue ball above center on that opening break there in 10 ball, unless you're SVB. But Andy's got a real good chance here to get to the hill and be breaking for the set. He's got to work out the 3 to the 4, and then he should be pretty much out of the woods. There's a lot of room between the 2 and the 9. It may not look that way to you, but there's at least, I'm going to guess, a full diamond's width between the deuce and the 9. It's got a lot of room out there to get to it. I think his concern here is the 7 ball, which is the one right there in the middle of the table. Actually, might be the 6, but you know which one I mean. He's just got to get by that ball and not come too far. He would have liked that to have stopped maybe 6 inches shorter. If he can miss the 9, he'll be fine. If he clips the 9, that's gonna maybe take him at the 3 a little bit. Nicely done. Doesn't want it on the rail. He's not there. That's good. Just like low right here, one rail kind of at the left side of that 6 ball, sort of down to the head spot. That's the target. Well, that worked out. Well, that wasn't where he wanted to be. Now he's going to have to maybe go around the 8. He may be able to draw it just straight down to the short rail. really done well with his cue ball this set. I think that's been the key to Danny having control of this match, is his position play has been much better than Amar's. And he's negotiated some pretty tricky outs too. So on the hill for Danny, and he'll be breaking for the match at 6-4. Our next match is at 11:30. It'll be a one-loss side match. I don't know that we have our players determined yet, because everything's feeding in from this round. So when this is over, we'll find out and let you know.
Josh Roberts and Shaw.
I have just been given the word by Mr. Justin. We have Josh Roberts, who you saw yesterday when he played against Scott Frost. And Scott really had his way with him. And Josh's opponent is Jason Shaw. And if you're familiar with Jason, you know how enjoyable it is really to watch him play. He's a quick draw, Jason Shaw, the Glasgow gunslinger. So that's coming up in about 30 minutes, and looks like we're going to be on time for that. Ball? Yes. But the two is covered by the 10. It has no pocket. The one is obviously a very difficult shot, and you're not going to get anywhere near the two ball. I'm not sure there's any advantage to pocketing this ball. I wonder if he could possibly bank it and come up here behind the deuce. I don't think he's got the angle up. I might even consider just playing all cue ball up here behind the 210. Three rail the one, and as long as it doesn't get much past the eight, you'd be all right, but he's doing something else. But now he's not sure what to do, and I don't blame him. Ball, I don't think he can get there. Wow, he threaded two needles there. At best, he's got his a bank. But I don't really see the advantage to that, because the 10's going to hit the 4, and you don't know where that's going. So it's probably an all-out safety here. Could have been a little bit better, because this is not a hard ball to hit. Well, you know, now that I have another peek at the table, I was looking at the monitor. As I look out there over at the table, maybe this is a little bit more difficult to hit than I first had thought. Because just because he's got to get by the 10 ball to catch the second rail. But he's looking at going through the gap. I think he's going to back kick it one rail right through the gap. And he called it cross corner in the upper left. Hoping the cue ball sticks right there. It's not all that bad. I mean, certainly Danny has an open shot. Not routine by any means. Got the 9 to deal with, but I think Amar got all of that out of that that he could. He was looking at trying to, roll the cue ball up on the 10, just send the 4 to the cushion. I don't think he's got the angle to do that because he'll have to cut the 4 to miss the 10. Yeah, I think that's maybe better. Just fin it and go behind the 10 there. He can't cut the 4 in either pocket. I still think this is what he wants to do, but sometimes what you want to do can't be done. I like thinning the side here. Just do something simple. Don't overcomplicate it. Just move the 4 about 2 inches. Well, he left Amar the 4 in the corner. It was still the right choice, though. But he's really going to have to put a good stroke on this to get the cue ball across the table, at least halfway, 4 to 5. Let's see if he stays nice and still here. He did. He really did stay still. Oh, don't do that after a shot like that. Yeah, he's hooked. What a cruel game this pool is, huh, folks? It will beat you up and spit you out. Make a great shot under pressure. Just doesn't go your way. Beautiful shot, Amar. That's a really nice shot. I'll clap for that. I don't think that's an accident that he left him hooked. Maybe came out a little bit better than he could have hoped for, but he played the shot that way, expecting this possibility of a result. Was pretty much do or die for Amar. If he sold out on that ball, it's pretty much going to be match over. He'll take it. Every time he'll take it. Nicely struck. He could have come out better. Again, that's two really good shots in a row. Amar's got no reward for. He might be able to play this cross side. It's hard to tell how much of the other pocket he's got. I don't really see any other offensive shot. Wasn't jacked on the eight, he might consider cutting it all the way down, but the fact that the eight ball's there is making that much, much harder. Again, I think cross side is the only offense here. Seven could hurt him here too. He's gotta almost go in clean and two thirds of a pocket. Shot. Really good shot there. You know, I've assumed the whole rack that the seven goes in the side because neither player paid any attention to it. And for Amar to go look now, just a little bit confused as to why either player wouldn't have looked at that much earlier in the rack, unless he's just trying to judge position. I mean, this could be one of those where you've got to force it through the point. We'll know by the speed. If he whacks it, he has to force it through the point. Didn't look like it. He had to do that. I think he was maybe just more concerned about the angle on the eight. This can be a little tricky here. Got to be careful. Yeah, it came out all right, but a lot of bad things can happen there too. Now he's still got to do some work to get down here. May have to play this rail first. I can't tell quite how much of an angle, if any, he has. Maybe a low left draw, spin it up. Well done. A really nice piece of work there to get through those balls, especially the bank shot on the six. He cleaned the pocket with it. So at 6-5, Amar breaking for the last time in the match. Let's see if he adjusts on his cue ball. Remember the last time it went forward? It bounced back and then the top spin took it right into the side pocket. I would think he will definitely adjust where he hits the cue ball. definitely struck the cue ball much more below the center than he did the last time. And you can tell that he got a good result out of it. He's got a little bit of congestion there on the left rail, but he's thrilled to have this to start with. Really, the only ball that's of an issue is the six ball. My guess will be he's either going to wind up playing the 6-10 combo, or he'll wind up playing the 6 cross side with an angle where he can basically stop the cue ball for the 7. I think those are the only two possibilities there. Oh, don't want to be straight. Oh. He wanted more angle. He's going to have to pop this. Right where the cue ball is now would be just so perfect for the six ball cross. I don't know if he can get there. He may be going at the 10 with the cue ball here. Or he's playing for the combination. We'll know in a moment. Yeah, it's going to be the combination. And he got about as good on it as you could if you had ball in hand. So this to force a deciding rack. He's done it. Really nice work there by Amar. And we're going to play one more game to see who goes home and who goes on. This has actually been, in my opinion, a fairly well-played match. I do think that Danny has played just a little bit better from a cue ball standpoint. I think Amar has had a much more difficult time getting his six racks than Danny did getting his. But it doesn't matter now. So let's wish both guys good luck and hope that the table and the play on it is what will determine the winner here and not some unfortunate or ungodly piece of bad luck or good luck, whichever way you want to look at it. So here we go. Took a little off just to make sure he controlled the cue ball and came up dry. Two-five will go. Not sure if he has the lower right pocket. I don't think he does. He's going to have to cut this to our left, and that'll put a natural shape on the deuce. Can reach this, and I think he'll be able to make use of the 6 or the 7 to stop the cue ball. He just has to make sure the 2 doesn't tuck itself under the 4 after it hit makes the 5. Don't really think that's going to happen the way the 4 and the 5 are laying. must be concerned about where the two is going to go. I mean, he's not in the ideal spot for this combination. Plus, he's got to keep the cue ball there. Well, it turned out okay. He's going to have to play the 3-9 carom when he gets there. Don't think that combo goes, but nevertheless, he's got an opportunity to just steal this match from Danny. Preferred a little different angle on this where his cue ball won't wind up so close to the three. I think he's going to have to give it a little extra here, get the cue ball away from the three ball. Much a stop shot here. He can go forward just a little bit, but he wants to maintain that nice steep angle on the four because he wants to play the six in the same pocket as the four, obviously. And he's done that. So just three rails here, maybe not even hit the third rail. This is a well-earned and well-deserved victory here for Amar. He kept his composure throughout the whole match, made a really nice out there in the final rack. So 7-6 for Amar, he moves on. We'll see Danny in the nine ball, and we'll be up here in about 10 minutes or so with our next match. So stand by for Jason Shaw and Josh Roberts.